doing something, you have to have the idea that if I never come back, I'll accept that. If you can't accept that and you're worried about it, then you won't go very far. So you have to have what's called a warrior's attitude. You have to be able to accept whatever comes and deal with it as it comes, or your fear will inhibit it. Fear is the opposite of love. Hate is not the opposite of love. Fear is the opposite of love. Fear is high entropy. Yes, sir.
Just back to meditation, you said that fear was one of the blocks.
Oh, yes.
To successful meditation. What would that fear be about in relation to meditation?
People are afraid of many things having to do with meditation. One, when you meditate and get to know your consciousness, a lot of the things that you have kind of pushed down into your subconsciousness that you're not dealing with, fears, come up, and you have to deal with them. That's one thing that frightens people. Some people are afraid of the non-physical because they know that, or at least they feel there's non-physical beings out there, and they don't know that something isn't going to grab them. Some people are just afraid of losing the physical. You know, this is we hold onto this physical, you know, like it's our teddy bear. You know, it makes us feel safe. And when you lose that, you're no longer in the physical. You're just a point of consciousness existing in a void. When you get to that point, you have no physical. You've got no physical matter reality. There's no earth. There's no universe. There's nothing. Just you and the void and nothing else. And that terrifies some people because it's, you know, they think they're never going to come back. They're stuck there, and they have habits that are physical, and those habits are hard to break.
Right. I do a mantra meditation using a Sanskrit mantra, and I was just wondering if the suggestion is that you just focus on the sound of the mantra, and
yes.
whenever your mind starts drifting, you
bring it back. Yes,
and that you would say would get me the desired.
Yes, that's a very good one. And you know what that mantra is doing? It's a Sanskrit mantra, and you know somebody may tell you that it's kind of a magic word, a special word that comes up from antiquity, etc., etc. What basically is going on there is when you're saying that mantra, you're pushing your thoughts away. That mantra is just fluff. It's to take up space in your mind, because if you weren't saying that mantra, you'd have all these thoughts. So you say that just to occupy your mind, keep your mind occupied. You could do the same thing by looking at the lights going around or by listening to a kind of music. It occupies your mind so that you can let go of this, of all these thoughts, and experience your consciousness. So that's the point. You can make up mantras. Anybody in here wants to meditate with a mantra, you know, you can just make up something that has kind of a vibratory sound. I go into that in the book and repeat that. The idea is, just as he said, you just say the sound. You hear the sound in your head, not hear it with your physical ears, but you say it, you repeat it, you repeat it. If a thought comes in, you just put the thoughts aside, you go back to the mantra is like cotton candy. It's just fluff to occupy your mind so you don't run off with thoughts. That's its primary function. Yes, sir.
Well, did you ever come across a reality that was more dense or constricted than this one?
I'm not sure about more dense or concentrated. I've come into a lot of physical realities. They have different physics. So some of them are very different than this in the rule set and what you can do and what you can't do. Surprisingly, a lot of them are similar because evidently this makes a good learning lab. So a lot of them are similar. But you come across some. There are some realities and some systems that are not as nearly as controlled as this is. And in that sense, they have evolved to be very, I don't know, law of the jungle. These are not nice places. They're very lawless. I guess we could say that. They're very lawless places. Anything could happen anytime. Very dangerous places. So you go to these realities and there is a lot of evil. There's a lot of nastiness there. This reality has rules that keep that from happening to a large extent. It's not our end reality. It doesn't get into that. But there are some that are places that you wouldn't want to visit or live there. So yeah, they're quite different. This is one of the more lawful reality systems. I've been to some that are more lawful, where things are regulated even more than they are here. but this one is fairly lawful.
Sorry, John, last question. Are the dead still alive in all dimensions?
Are the dead still alive? Well, the dead never died. They're still alive. They are consciousness. Again, this body is just a hallucination. This body that you have here is a data stream that makes you see and feel and touch. It's a multiplayer, you know, simulation. And consciousness goes on. The body drops out. You come into this learning lab to learn. Okay, you learn as much as you can, and when you're not really learning much anymore, you leave. When you leave, you plan your next trip to learning, and then maybe you come back again. But yes, they go on, and every consciousness is connected to all consciousness. Everything is connected all the time, but whether or not you have access to it is another thing. Now, just because you have died and you're now aware, your focus has shifted from here to a non-physical reality, does that suddenly make you aware of things and do you become enlightened and knowledgeable? No, not at all. There are many beings that are non-physical that are not any more aware than, you know, the average person walking down the street. And there's a lot of beings that are non-physical that are very nasty. You know, the non-physical has less constraints on it, therefore it has more variety. We only have so many, you know, billion different life forms on this planet because that's all that we can develop within the constraints of this planet, within the physics of the planet. You go to a place that the constraints are broader and looser, it can develop a whole lot more stuff. So we're a subset. There's things in the non-physical that are more beautiful, more love than anything you'll find here, and things that are more evil and more, you know, awful than things you'll find here. We're just a little narrow piece. Evolution fills out the whole gamut of things. So no, you don't gain consciousness quality. You don't lose entropy just by dying. That doesn't give you the keys to, you know, to the door. You still have to grow up. You had a question earlier. Did you give up?
I was kind of grasping that it might be connected with the meditation thing. Yeah. I'm a Reiki healer, and I'm sure that there are a few others mm-hmm. as well. And we have symbols that we use when we're doing our healing. And I'm wondering what that's about, how you connect with them. Are they a thing that everybody that is in the collective unconscious and you all join up with it? Or is it just a fluff thing?
No, most of the symbols that you have that you use are tools. They're tools to help you focus your intent. Okay, if you you know, doing your Reiki, you have these tools that you use with your consciousness, with your mind. Healers will have tools. You know, if I look at if I'm healing someone and I look at a thing of their body, a light form of their body, I may take a bright white light and shine it on that dark spot. Right. Well, these are all tools. It's not that the white light does anything. It's not that the dark spot's really a dark spot. It's because my intent defines that. If I say I want to see, you know, we're just getting data. You can define how the data comes into you. So if I, in my intent, say I want to see all the good tissue as light and white and the stuff that's bad as dark, I'll get it that way. If I say just the opposite, I want to see all the good stuff that's dark, you know, and the bad stuff is light, I'll get it that way. You'll get the data any way you want. It's just a tool. And if I see this beam of light going, I may think that's a laser or some other kind of fancy thing because I'm a physicist and I think lasers are neat. But if you think it's something else, that's fine too. It's just focusing your intent. These are tools that we make up to help us focus. So you use that tool because when you use that tool, your intent is intending for something to happen.